Well, good morning, and welcome to the worship service of Mount Zion Baptist Church. We are so glad that you are listening today, and we pray that God is going to bless you during our time together this morning. Well, here at Mount Zion on Easter, we like to continue a tradition that was started by the early church, and that is whenever two Christians would meet on the road, they would greet one another in this way. One would say, "He is risen!" And the other would reply, "He is risen indeed." And so let's do that this morning as we begin. He is risen. He is risen indeed. And we are so thankful for that, aren't we? Well, happy Easter, everyone. This is a special day in the life of our church. And it's a day that we really like to make a big deal over, isn't it? That this morning, I know that this is not the way that we usually celebrate Easter. I mean, we're used to being in church together to celebrate this day. But unfortunately, that's not possible this year. But I do want you to know that while we are not together, I certainly am missing seeing you guys. I miss seeing your faces. I miss getting to shake your hands and hug your neck. And I look so forward to the time when we are going to be able to get back together and do that again. But you know, I do believe that as we strive to honor the government, which has asked us to stay home while this virus runs its course, and as we strive to love our neighbor by staying away from them, I believe that God will honor our efforts and that He will be blessed as we gather together through these recorded messages. I also wanted to remind you that this is the time, Easter is the time when we as a church take up our Annie Armstrong Easter offering, which supports our North American missionaries. And so if you'd like to give to that, or if you'd like to go ahead and give your weekly contribution, your tithe, you can do that by mailing your check to P.O. Box 326, Kayser, North Carolina, 28020. And so we appreciate your help with that as well. Now, if you have your Bibles, and I hope you do, I want to encourage you to turn with me this morning to the book of Acts. Today we are going to be reading from Acts chapter 2, beginning in verse 22. That's Acts chapter 2, beginning in verse 22. While you're turning there, I want to share with you a little story. Alexander the Great of Greece was one of the greatest military leaders in all of history. During the brief years of his rule, his army swept through most of the known world, conquering everything in its path. Even the mighty Persian Empire proved to be helpless against Alexander's armies. Well, as the soldiers marched their way across Persia, they went into the villages and cities and took whatever they wanted. Nothing in the empire was spared. The soldiers even went and plundered the royal palace of King Darius. The story goes that while in the palace, one of the soldiers found an attractive leather bag that had been filled with rocks. Now, the man had no need for the rocks, but what he did need was a bag to carry his food. And so he dumped out all of the stones and kept the bag as his lunchbox. Well, you can imagine the soldier's dismay when he later found that the bag that he used to carry his food had previously been used by King Darius for the sole purpose of carrying the crown jewels of Persia. Because of the soldier's ignorance of the value of those precious stones, he had thrown away the greatest treasure in the kingdom. Now, many of us can relate this morning to the feelings of loss that was experienced by that soldier. Most of us, I'm sure, at some point in time have thrown away something of great value. It may have been some material object like a ring or a watch, or it could have been a valued relationship, something like a friend or a family member. But even though any of those things would be considered a great loss, they can never compare to the tragedy of a person who throws away the opportunity to receive salvation from their sins. It can never compare to the person who throws away the opportunity to meet the Lord Jesus Christ. Well, this morning, as we begin reading in Acts chapter 2, we discover that the Apostle Peter is talking to a group of Jews who have done just that. They had heard about Jesus. Many of them had seen Jesus. But instead of accepting him as the Lord and Savior of their lives, they rejected him. And as Peter speaks to these Jews, his goal is to convince them of the value of the treasure that they have cast away and of their great need to discover it once again. So let's read about it beginning in verse 22. Peter says, "Fellow Israelites, listen to this. Jesus of Nazareth was a man accredited by God to you by miracles, wonders, and signs, which God did among you through him, as you yourselves know. This man was handed over to you by God's deliberate plan and foreknowledge, and you, with the help of wicked men, put him to death by nailing him to a cross. But God raised him from the dead, freeing him from the agony of death, because it was impossible for death to keep its hold on him." Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this passage of Scripture that we are reading today. We thank you for these words of Peter that remind us of this great gift that you sent into this world. Father, it reminds us of the great plan that you had to save us from our sins. And Father, today as we celebrate Easter, what a reminder it is of how much you love us and how anyone, if they would simply repent and turn to Christ, that they can be saved. Father, we thank you for that good news. And Father, this morning as we lift our praise and our thoughts and our needs to you, we want to remember those people who are around us who are suffering from illness. We know that there are several people, even in our community, who have been affected by this virus that's going around our world. And Father, we know that they are sick. Some are in the hospital from it. And Father, we pray today that you would just touch them with your healing hands. We pray, Father, that you would strengthen their bodies and enable them to overcome this. Father, we pray for those who have lost loved ones. We know that there are many of those around our country and around our world today. And we pray, Father, that you would just bring peace into these families' hearts. Father, help them to know that you are with them, that you love them, and that you are able to help them get through this difficult, difficult time. Father, we pray for those who are well. We ask, Lord, that you would continue to keep us that way. Protect us from this sickness, and we pray, Lord, that you would just help us to overcome it as quickly as possible so that we can get back to life as we know it. Father, thank you for loving us. Thank you for Jesus. We pray this in his name. Amen. Now, before we go back and begin to break this text down, let's take just a moment. I kind of want to set the context for the story we're reading today. If you were to go back to the beginning of Acts chapter 2, what you would find is that something really special had taken place in Jerusalem. While the believers had all gathered together in the upper room, the Bible says that the Spirit of God came down on all those who were gathered there. And when the Spirit came down, it sounded like a great rushing wind. And what looked like fire came down and rested on the believers. And the Bible tells us that each one began to speak in other tongues. And this doesn't mean that they were babbling incoherently, but instead, the Spirit of God was allowing them to speak in different languages so that everybody who came to see them was able to understand them, even though they were from all different parts of the world. And so this crowd that began to gather, they were confused about what was going on. They were hearing these Galileans speak different languages, and they couldn't figure out how it was happening. They wanted to know what was taking place. And so Peter takes this opportunity to explain to them what is happening. And what he says is that what you are seeing is biblical prophecy being fulfilled. He says this is what the prophet Joel was talking about when he said in the last days the Spirit of God would be poured out. It was a sign of the beginning of the period of time that would end with the great and glorious day of the Lord. And then Peter ends in verse 21 with a quote from Joel that says, "And for everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord, they will be saved." Now, We love that verse, don't we? That's where our hope is. But have you ever thought about the flip side of that verse? If all of those who call upon the name of the Lord will be saved, then what's going to happen to all of those who don't? What's going to happen to all those who reject the Lord? And the answer to that, well, it's that God's wrath is going to be poured out on them. They are going to be condemned for all eternity. And so it's very important for people to call upon the name of the Lord, right? But who is this Lord that they need to call on? Who is this Lord that can save them from their sins? Well, Peter is going to tell them that it is the very same Lord that they have already rejected. It's the Lord Jesus Christ, the treasure whom they have cast away. And so as we come to verse 22, Peter begins to explain to the people why Jesus is so valuable and why they need to accept him into their lives. And so he begins by first sharing with them who Jesus is. He tells them who Jesus is. Let's look again at verse 22. He says, "Fellow Israelites, listen to this. Jesus of Nazareth was a man accredited by God to you by miracles, wonders, and signs, which God did among you through him, as you yourselves know." Now, in order to explain who Jesus is, Peter first describes for the people his manhood. He says to them, Jesus was a man. And we know that to be true, don't we? Every Christmas we read from John's Gospel where we are told that the Word, which is talking about Jesus, what we're told that the Word became flesh and made his dwelling here with us. And so Jesus was a man, right? He was born to a mother, just like we all were. Well, we know that from time to time Jesus got hungry, just like we all do. He got thirsty, just like we do. At times he would become tired and weary, just like we do. And he even had to endure temptation, just like we do. He was completely man. And that's important because in order for Jesus to become mankind's Savior, he had to first become man. You see, in order for man to be saved, we had to have a sinless sacrifice. And the blood of bulls and the blood of goats, that just wouldn't get it. In order for man to be saved, a perfect man, a sinless man, had to die in our place. And unfortunately, there had never been, nor would there ever be, such a man. And so what did God do? God became that man for us. Theologians refer to this as Jesus' state of humiliation. When he left heaven in order to come to earth to be one of us, he lowered himself. He humbled himself. In fact, Philippians chapter 2, verse 5 through 8 tells us this. It says, Jesus, who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage, but rather he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. See, Jesus was completely man. But it doesn't stop there. Peter continues and he says that while he was completely man, he was also completely God. Look at verse 22 again. Jesus of Nazareth, who was a man accredited by God to you by miracles, wonders, and signs, which God did among you through him, as you yourselves know. So we see that God accredited Jesus. Some of your translations, it says that he was approved by God. But approved by God to be what? Well, if you drop down to verse 36, Peter will tell us. At the end of his message, Peter says this. He says that God has made this Jesus both Lord and Christ. And so this Jesus, who is completely man, is also the Lord. He's the Christ, the Messiah. And the people who heard that, they would say, whoa, wait a minute. Peter, how in the world can you say that? How do you know that's true? And Peter says, well, it's because God accredited him with these miracles, wonders, and signs. I mean, we know from reading the Gospels that wherever Jesus went, he did all sorts of amazing things, didn't he? He healed sick people. He caused the lame to walk. He caused the blind to see. With a word from his mouth, he calmed the raging storm. He took just a few loaves of bread and some tiny fish, and he multiplied those so that he could feed over 5,000 people. I mean, Jesus was incredible. And why did he do all these things? Well, some would say he did them so that he could help people, you know, who were in need. And of course, that's part of it. But folks, the main reason for the miracles was so that the people would see them and then believe that Jesus was who he said he was. He created fish and bread to feed all those people. Not just because they were hungry, but he did so in order to validate the claim that he made about himself when he said, "I am the bread of life." He raised Lazarus from the dead, not just to comfort Mary and Martha, but also to validate the claim that he was the resurrection and the life. Every time that he performed a miracle, every time that he did something amazing, it was God proving that Jesus was who he claimed to be, the anointed one, the Messiah, the Son of God. And Peter says that is who Jesus is. He is fully man, but at the same time, he is fully God. He is your Messiah. He is your Savior. He is your Lord. So, that's who Jesus is. Now, let's move on and let's see how the people treated him. That's going to be our second point today, how the people treated Jesus. Look in verse 23. It says, "This man was handed over to you by God's deliberate plan and foreknowledge, and you, with the help of wicked men, put him to death by nailing him to the cross." Now, when you first read this, the first thing you have to ask yourself, and the Israelites would have asked this, is, Peter, if what you are saying is true, then how in the world could someone like Jesus, someone who was fully man and fully God, die? I mean, that doesn't make sense, does it? How could the God-man be killed by anyone? Well, that would be impossible, except for the fact that that is the way that God had it planned. In eternity past, the triune God, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, had determined that in order for man to be saved, then Jesus would be born into this world and die for our sins. That's why Jesus is referred to in the Bible as being the Lamb of God who was slain from the very foundation of the world. It was God's plan that Jesus would die all along. And I say that to you so that you will know that the reality is no one took Jesus' life from him, but instead he voluntarily gave it up. In fact, if you remember, in Matthew's gospel, when the soldiers came and Peter pulled out his sword and he cuts off one of the fellow's ears, Jesus said to Peter, he said, "Peter, put your sword away. Put your sword away. Don't you know that if I wanted to, I could call 12 legions of angels and they would come and save me? If I wanted out of this," Jesus said, "I could get out." He said in John 10, he said, "No one takes my life from me, but I give it up willingly." You see, Jesus was not some helpless dish rag who couldn't save himself. No, Peter says it was determined in eternity past that Jesus would give up his right to save himself in order for him to be able to save you and me. It was all part of God's plan. But you know, just because it was all part of God's plan, that doesn't lessen the guilt of the ones who killed him. Jesus' blood was still on their hands. It was a Skip Hising once said. He said, on one hand, Jesus' death was a victorious plan, but on the other hand, it was also a vicious plot. And who instigated this vicious plot? Who put Jesus to death? Well, Peter looks at these Israelites who are standing here in Jerusalem, and he says, it was you. It was you, along with the help of wicked men, men like Annas and Caiaphas, the high priest, men like Herod, and men like Pontius Pilate. You put him to death. You were the ones who stood in the crowd that day and yelled, crucify him, crucify him. And even if these people weren't in the crowd that day, all of them were a part of the Jewish religious system that had rejected and killed the Christ. And the unbelievable part was that when they did that, they knew exactly who he was. They knew who he was when they killed him. I think about that soldier we talked about in the beginning, the one who threw the jewels away, threw the jewels out of the bag. I mean, at least he didn't recognize what they were, right? He had no understanding of the value of those stones. But these men of Israel, as Peter just said, they had seen the miracles. They had experienced the signs and the wonders. They knew exactly who Jesus was. In fact, if you were to look in John chapter 3, if you remember that story when Nicodemus comes and he meets with Jesus, do you remember how Nicodemus addressed him? John chapter 3, verse 2. He says that he came to Jesus at night and he said, Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God. For no one could perform the signs that you were doing if God were not with him. You see, they knew who Jesus was. Even the religious leaders knew that Jesus had been sent by God. They knew his value. They understood his greatness. But guess what? They rejected him anyway. Why? Well, it's like it says in John 3:19. This is the verdict. Light has come into the world, but people love darkness instead of light because their deeds were evil. You see, they valued other things more than they valued Jesus. They valued their religious system more than they valued Jesus. They valued their rules and their regulations more than they valued Jesus. They valued their sinful lifestyle more than they valued Jesus. And so what did they do? They rejected him. And in their rejection, they put him to death on the cross. That's how they treated Jesus. That's how they treated the one who had come to save them. And of course, they thought that once that had happened, they would never have to worry about Jesus again, right? Once he had been crucified, they thought he is gone. He is out of the picture. They thought that this was the end of his story. But thanks be to God, it was not the end, was it? No. And so we're going to move on. Well, we've seen how they treated Jesus, but now let's see what God did in response. And what did God do? Well, look in verse 24. It says, but God raised him from the dead, freeing him from the agony of death, because it was impossible for death to keep its hold on him. Peter said, folks, you killed him. You killed him. But it's not over. The story's not finished because God raised him up again. He freed him from death. And I love the way that Peter puts this, because he says it was impossible for death to hold him. And why was it impossible? Well, think about it. I mean, how could the one who is the resurrection and the life be held by death? How can the one who has no beginning ever come to an end? How can the one who causes all things to exist ever cease to exist? He couldn't. It would be impossible for that to happen, wouldn't it? And so as Peter is declaring to these Jews the resurrection of Jesus, once again, he's letting them know how great and how powerful and how valuable this Jesus really is. He was resurrected. And some would say, well, I mean, what's the big deal about that? What's so important about the resurrection? I mean, why do you Christians, you know, make such a big deal out of Easter? Why do you have this whole holiday to celebrate this event? Well, the answer is because the resurrection is really the foundation of all of our hope, isn't it? The resurrection is the foundation of our faith. The reason it's so important is because the resurrection proves beyond a shadow of a doubt that Jesus really is who he claimed to be and that he really did what he claimed to do, and that is die for our sins. And so without the resurrection, we would have no proof that it really took place. I think about the story back in Matthew chapter 9 where Jesus heals a man who's paralyzed. And when he first went up to the man, he said to him, he said, your sins have been forgiven. And when the religious leaders heard that, oh, they just had a fit. They said, oh, he's speaking blasphemy. How can this man forgive sins? And Jesus looked at them and he said, well, which do you think is easier for me to do? To say your sins are forgiven? Or for me to say, rise, take up your mat and walk? And of course, the answer is it's a whole lot easier to say your sins are forgiven because, I mean, anybody can say that. I could say your sins are forgiven, and how in the world would you ever know if it's true or not? You wouldn't be able to, would you? But on the other hand, if I said, take up your mat and walk, folks, that's hard. And it's hard because everyone will be able to see the results of what I've said. If I say, take up your mat and walk, and the guy continues to lay there on the ground, then everybody knows I'm a fraud. But if I say, take up your mat and walk, and the guy stands up and walks away, then I must have the power to do what I have claimed, right? What I have said must be true. And so Jesus looks at these religious leaders and he says to them, he says, but I want you to know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sin. And so he said to the paralyzed man, get up, take your mat, and go home. And guess what? That is exactly what happened. The paralyzed man got up, picked up his mat, and he went on his merry little way, proving not only that Jesus had the power to heal a person, but more importantly, that Jesus had the power to forgive a person's sin. It proved it for those who were standing around watching. And folks, that's really what the resurrection does for us. Jesus said that he was going to die for our sins. He said that his death would be the sacrifice that would make it possible for you and me to be made right with God. But in reality, I mean, anybody could have said that. I could tell you that I'm going to die for your sins, but that doesn't make it true, does it? And so when Jesus died on the cross, his followers, they hoped that his death would bring forgiveness. They wanted it to be true, but they didn't really know for sure, did they? But on that third day, when God raised Jesus from the dead, at that point in time, those disciples knew beyond a shadow of a doubt that everything that Jesus had said, all the claims that he made, they were all true. It was all real. And so since Jesus rose from the dead, then that meant that everything that Jesus had said about himself and about God, it was true. Since Jesus rose from the dead, then that meant that what he said about God loving us, that was true. Since Jesus rose from the dead, it meant all that he said about God hearing us when we pray, that was true. Since Jesus rose from the dead, then that meant that all that he said about him going to prepare a place for us in heaven, that was true. And since Jesus truly rose from the dead, then that means that he was not just another prophet. He was not just another good person. He wasn't just a good teacher. No, Jesus rose from the dead, and it meant that he is in fact the Messiah, the Son of the living God. He is the one who would come to take away the sins of the world. And because of the resurrection, the disciples no longer had a hope-so salvation. But since Jesus was raised, they now had a no-so salvation. Because with the resurrection, they didn't just have hope. They now had a living hope. The risen Savior, Jesus Christ. And as Peter is talking to this crowd, he's letting them know that this is what they could have had they not been so stubborn. This is what they could have had if they would have simply believed. God had given them the greatest gift ever. God had sent to them the most valuable possession that he had, his own son. And instead of receiving him, this crowd had simply thrown him away. They had rejected and murdered the Son of God. And as Peter is speaking these words, there were some in the crowd that day that they heard them and they continued not to believe. But there were some in that crowd. In fact, the Bible tells us there were over 3,000 who heard these words and came to understand the seriousness of the sin that they committed. They were cut to the heart, the Bible says. They were overcome with grief and sadness and even fear. I mean, if they had done this to God's Son, then what was God going to do to them? They were absolutely terrified. And so they cried out to Peter. They said, "What can we do? How can we save ourselves from the wrath of God?" And here's the really great part of this story. Peter didn't look out at that crowd and say, "It's too late for you." He didn't say, "After what you have done, there's nothing you can do." No. Instead, he looked out at that crowd and he told them to do what we all have to do. Verse 38, Peter replied, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins." Repent, that means turn away from your sin. Be baptized, that means identifying with Christ, accepting him as your Lord and Savior. And the Bible tells us that there were over 3,000 people who did that. And they were gloriously saved. They had rejected and killed the very Son of God. That they had thrown him away like a bag of old rocks. But through repentance and faith, they were able to find him once again. And folks, do you realize that the same thing is true for all of us? You may be listening today, and you would have to admit that you've known about Jesus for a long time. You've heard the Bible stories. You've read the gospel tracts. And like these Jews, you know that Jesus is the Son of God. But instead of receiving him as the Lord and Savior of your life, you've rejected him. You've cast him aside. And you might say, "Well, I've not rejected Jesus. No, I've just simply not done anything with him." But can I tell you, that's the same thing. To not receive Christ is to reject him. To not become his friend, the Bible says, is to be his enemy. There is no such thing as doing nothing with Jesus. You hear about him and you either accept him as your Savior or you reject him. And maybe that's what you've been doing for years now. And if it is, I believe that the message that Peter had for the Israelites is the same message that he has for you. No matter what you've done, no matter how far down the dark path you've gone, no matter how many times you have told him no, today, you have been given another chance. You've been given another opportunity to repent and turn to Christ. And I would say to you, don't throw him away again. Don't discard him like you would a bunch of worthless stones. Accept him as your Savior and Lord so that you can be forgiven and then possess the most precious and valuable thing that can ever be had. And that is a relationship with God. You know, I can't think of a better way to end an Easter message than by giving someone an opportunity to do just that. And so as we close today, what I would like to do is I would like to lead you in a prayer to accept Christ as your Savior. I don't believe that these are magic words that I'm giving you, but I do believe that if as you pray them, you believe them in your heart, then you will become a child of God. And if you'd like to do that today, then would you please pray along with me? Let's pray. Dear Lord, I know that I'm a sinner, and I ask for your forgiveness. I believe that Jesus died for my sins, and I believe that he rose from the dead. And so I turn from my sins, and I invite you to come into my heart and life. I want to trust and follow you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. In your name I pray, amen. Well, as I said, if you prayed that prayer today, and if you meant it in your heart, then according to the Word of God, you are now part of God's family. Your sins have been forgiven, you have been made right with God, and you now have a home in heaven where you are one day going to go and spend all eternity with Him. And folks, that's not just true for those who prayed that prayer today, but it's true for anyone who has ever trusted Christ as their Savior. And so because of this, no matter what's going on in our world right now, no matter how difficult life may become, as followers of Jesus Christ, we have hope, don't we? Hope, because we know that Jesus Christ is risen from the dead. He is risen indeed. Amen. Well, thank you for listening today, and I hope that our time together has been a blessing to you. And until next time, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Have a blessed Easter.